Please stand for the coming in of the light. Good morning. Welcome to worship this morning, all of you in-house and those of you online. Let us begin with our call to worship. Today we gather around God's table from near and far. Though we differ in language, custom, and tradition, for there is one Lord, one faith, one baptism. We are one, and together we remember our Lord Jesus. He gave himself up for us so we could be reconciled to God. Our opening prayer. Today, God, we confess our fumblings and failures in accomplishing unity as we set aside yet another day to remind ourselves of the task. On this World Communion Sunday, give us eyes to recognize your reflection in the eyes of Christians everywhere. Give us a mind to accept and celebrate our differences. Give us a heart big enough to love your children everywhere. We thank you for setting a table with space enough for us all. Amen. Our opening hymn is Lord, We Come to Ask Your Blessings in the Faith We Sing, number 2230.
so good to see you both.
Good morning. We've missed you. What a blessing to have you back. Thank you for coming. Have you been following along at home? I heard you were, so you kind of know where we're at, huh? Okay, well, let me get situated here. And we're going to read chapter 10. How many chapters are there? I know, Claire, your name's up on the board, isn't it? Up on the screen, yes. How exciting. Well, there's 30-some chapters. So we're going to be here for a while, aren't we? Clear into next year. Won't that be fun? Yeah, I think so. Okay, well, let me get started here. This one is the Coal Valley Neighbors. You know, I read this the other day, and I read it again this morning. And I have to tell you, Pastor, I think God is talking to us through these books and through these chapters. Because after I read it, the people in the church can really understand what I'm saying. Coal Valley Neighbors. Claire knocked politely at the office door, church office door. Tap, tap, tap. My father is probably studying for his sermon, she told Bill, who stood patiently beside her. Come in, called Parson Henry. Claire pushed the door open and ran around the desk and gave her father a hug. Bill stepped inside the office. I bet you do that too, don't you, Claire?
Yeah.
Hi, Papa, said Claire. Bill and I want to read more about Jesus and what he said and did. Can you tell us where to look in our Bible? Start reading the Gospel of Matthew, said Pastor Parson Henry. Then read Mark, Luke, and John. A knock at the door interrupted them. They turned to see the children's Bible teacher standing by the open door and wiping her eyes. Good afternoon, Miss Emily, said Parson Henry. Say, are you all right? Are those tears I see? She answered softly, I rode my horse down to Coal Valley today. It was the first time I've ever been there. What I saw made me cry. Those old houses are very dirty and run down. I don't know how anyone lives in them. And the people are so poor. Their children don't even have shoes. I've never been to the old mining town, admitted Parson Henry. I knew some people stayed there after the mine shut down, but I didn't know what happened to them. Is there something we can do for them? Asked Miss Emily. Bill and Claire both spoke up at once. The four special words. Miss Emily didn't understand, so Claire told her about the events of the past 2 days. Bill and I want to follow Jesus, said Claire. Here's a chance to ask, what would Jesus do? Parson Henry's eyes looked thoughtful. Remember the story Jesus told about the Good Samaritan, he asked? Well, people in Coal Valley are neighbors to us. Jesus would want us to help them, especially if they are poor and not well. Can we have another picnic and invite them? Asked Claire. And give them some of our shoes? Asked Bill. Miss Emily glanced at Parson Henry and said, I'm not sure what our church members would say. Claire said, I've heard some people say we should stay away from Coal Valley. Parson Henry frowned. Our members might not be ready for this idea, and I think it's too soon to organize another picnic right now. Just then, barking and neighing sounded outside. Everyone rushed to the window and looked out. They saw two dogs chasing a cat around the churchyard. The cat dashed underneath Sugar Bell. Sugar Bell is Miss Emily's horse. Sugar Bell kicked and reared until her reins broke loose. Then she took off running. Parson Henry dashed out of his office and followed Sugar Bell across the field. I'll catch her, he shouted. Who are your neighbors? And what can you do to be a good neighbor? That's some thinking, isn't it, to do? Right. Well, in Romans 13:9, it says, love others as much as you love yourself. And as a church, we do that. We try to help others. It says that you can learn about the Good Samaritan in Luke 10, verses 25 through 37. So, let's take this to prayer now, shall we? Dear God, we thank you for all the blessings we have. Help us to remember our neighbors near and far, and to help them as much as we can. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Now, today is a special day, and I am so happy you're here to help me share it, because today we get to leave the sanctuary, and we're going to go down and out that hallway and have Sunday school for a few minutes. Yeah! Thank you for coming. Okay, follow me.
Thank you so much. We have been waiting to be able to have Sunday school since COVID. We have not had Sunday school, so you guys are making it happen. Nice. And all of the volunteers we have make it happen as well. Thank you all. It's time for our prayer time and praise, and I think the first thing we do is give God praise for the fact that we are starting Sunday school again. So, and thank you for all the volunteers that are willing to give of their time as well. So what a blessing. And then we do have some other prayers. We definitely are lifting up those that are in natural disaster areas. And it just seems to me like maybe I've just heard of it more this week. It just keeps getting more and more. And so we pray for all of those that are in the path of natural disasters and more, I guess, rain, et cetera, to come for Florida. So we keep them in prayer. We also want to lift up in prayer the family of Donna Sitzman of Kingsley. Help me. Okay, so thank you. I always appreciate when you help me on this. So Dana Sitzman from the Kingsley Pearson area, unfortunately, Dana passed away. He died in a farming accident yesterday. So we pray for his family, and we pray for all of the farmers. It is such dangerous work and long hours, and so thank you for bringing that to our attention, and all of the our prayers go to that family. We also pray for Aaron and Craig, who are brothers of Mark, and they are battling cancer, and so we keep them in our prayers as well. And we pray for Arlene Dean's family, who passed away, and Arlen Dean, I apologize. Again, thank you very much. Arlen Dean, who passed away, and he was a former South Sioux City police officer. So we pray for that family as well. We also continue to keep in our prayers those that are in hospitals, recovering from surgery, preparing for surgery, and those that are recovering that are having an extra difficult time. So we pray for those as well. We pray for our sister Karen in Homer. Last week, you probably heard me say that she was having a heart valve replacement last week. Well, it got changed to tomorrow. So we pray for her. In addition to that, Eldon, her husband, has an injury that just happened, I think yesterday. He He has a lot of back pain, a huge amount of back pain, and they think maybe there's some compressed spinal cord injury going on. So their children are going to take care of them. One will stay with Eldon while Karen is in the hospital. The other will go with Karen to the hospital. And so we keep them in prayer. And then you also probably remember me telling you about twin little babies that were born last Saturday. They're 8 days old. And I got to see pictures of Mama holding one and Daddy holding the other. And so they are just teeny tiny, a pound and a half each, but they seem to be doing well, so we praise God for that. We also hold in prayer those that are suffering from the hold that addictions have on them as well as their families, and we keep them in prayer. And then I also want to say that I am praising God and thanking God for all of our leadership people. This is the time of year where we transition, and by the end of December, one team of leadership will go out and another team comes in. Some of the same team will remain, some are new. So whether you've been on leadership for a long time and agreed to continue, or you are going to be new to our leadership team in January, I just say thank you and blessings to you, and let's keep everyone in prayer. It can be difficult to be on leadership team and making the decisions that we have to make, so I thank you. And then praise, I thank you very much. It is Pastor Appreciation Month, and you all as a parish got me a beautiful, it reminds me, so look at the stained glass windows. So there is a thousand piece puzzle that is like a Tree of Life puzzle with the colors of stained glass. And it isn't here yet. When it's here, I'll bring the box and show it to you. And then whenever it is that I get that 1,000-piece puzzle together, I will mount it and put it in my office. But thank you so much. I will treasure that a lot, so I appreciate that. And I would like us to join together in prayer. Let's take a moment of silence to lift up any other prayers that you guys have. And then we'll come together lifting all of it up to God. Let us pray. Lord, in the hustle and bustle of the morning, trying to get from one place to another, we may have neglected our prayer life and conversation with you this morning, and so we take this opportunity to lift up everything that is on our hearts. And Lord, as brothers and sisters united in Christ, we thank you for knitting us together. We pray on this World Communion Sunday for each other around the world. We thank you, God, that we are a huge family united by you, with you in the center. Lord, we pray for those around the world that are suffering, either physically, emotionally, mentally, or spiritually. We pray for all those around the world who have a hard time reaching you or getting to you or being in a place where they can worship safely. And God, we thank you for our community right here, our community of believers, that we can experience your love together and talk about it. God, we lift up not only the prayers that are in our hearts here in this space, but also for our brothers and sisters online. We lift those up and we come together, united together in the prayer that your Son taught others, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen.
They didn't claim that anything they had was their own. Instead, they shared everything they owned. With great power, the apostles continued their teaching. They were telling people that the Lord Jesus had risen from the dead, and God's grace was working powerfully in all of them. So there was no needy persons among them. From time to time, those who owned land or houses sold them. They brought the money from the sales. They put it down at the apostles' feet. It was then given out to anyone who needed it. The word of God for the people of God.
Thank you, Rochelle. Today we continue our series, I Love My Church. This week we're talking about giving. And I want you to hear this sentence and kind of let it sink in. Sacrificing and meeting needs are abundant expressions of love. I'm going to say it again. Sacrificing and meeting needs are abundant expressions of love. Any parent understands sacrifice. Anyone in a relationship understands sacrifice. Webster says, sacrifice is an act of giving up something which is valued for the sake of something else regarded as more important or worthy. Christians understand sacrifice. The biggest sacrifice of all was Christ's death on a cross for us. This is World Communion Sunday, and around the world we remember together the sacrifice of Christ. God knew our need to be with him. In an abundance of love for us, Christ did what we could not do for ourselves. What an amazing expression of love. Today, we do, in fact, continue the series, I Love My Church, and we're talking about giving. And this is one of the least favorite topics for many pastors, because we know that some people listening don't want to hear it. I still have some mental scars from a time where I preached on giving. I was about 6 months into a new appointment, and I thought that I gave a sermon that was pretty good on tithing and offering, and I talked about how it's a spiritual discipline, and I spoke about how we never do it perfect, but we do the best that we can, and that God, in his grace and his mercy, understands that we don't do it as good as we should sometimes, but we keep trying, and so I thought it was delivered with love. Well, a couple hours later, I got a phone call, and I was told by the SPRC chair, that's the Pastor Parish Relations Committee, there will be a meeting at 4:00 this afternoon, and you are expected to be there. Okay. So 4:00 comes, and I go into where we are having the meeting in church, and there are the five Pastor Parish Relations Committee people. And they proceed to tell me one at a time, as if they had planned it, one at a time, why it is that it is a bad idea and now forbidden for me to preach on tithing ever again. We do not need to hear it. We can take care of it ourselves. Do not preach on tithing. I listened. I listened to all five of them. I didn't say a word. You know me. You know how hard it is for me to sit and not say a word. I did not say a word, and at the end, the lay leader of the group said, well, because you're not saying anything, you must be in agreement with us, so happy that you are. I said, you have mistaken my silence for agreement. And I proceeded to tell them why it was that I would continue to preach on tithing twice a year. And in fact, it is a spiritual discipline. And I told them there are many issues in Scripture that I will preach on along with that. So sorry if they are uncomfortable if I do so. I kid you not, I am not exaggerating. The lay leader pointed at the door with her finger. There is the door. Do not let it hit you in the butt. Different word, on your way out. Now, in the Methodist Church, the only one that can get rid of a pastor is the bishop. I was eagerly anticipating their conversation with the bishop of why they didn't like me preaching on tithing. I happily knew that would not happen. I will say that for the first year, it was very difficult at that church. But after that, it was amazing. God brought love into that church. I loved them. They loved me. They did this 180 that I have never seen before. And they financially gave. And the blessings were in abundance in that church for many reasons, not just for that reason. So why is it that they reacted that way? Well, I think they reacted that way because, like many people, it is uncomfortable to talk about money. It's uncomfortable to talk about money and giving money away. Money is our security. It feels like we're giving away our security. And this sermon is not about perfect tithing and perfect giving, because no one does it perfectly, and I assure you, I do not. And I will also tell you that often the enemy knows exactly my weakness and where to poke at me, and tithing is one of them. This sermon is about showing abundant love. We do a great job of showing abundant love in our community. As an example, the $5 gift cards that I've talked with you guys about, we had so many that we were able to bless many, every care provider in our local assisted living and long-term care services, and we still have a little bit left over, which is amazing. You guys as a parish give in abundance. We have a barrel that is out in the lobby area, fellowship hall area, and that is from the mission. And they are asking, and there is a list. There's a list outside that you can get that shows you the needs that they have. And they're not asking you to buy anything. If you would like to buy new underwear and new socks, okay, that is great. But if not, whatever gently used items that you have that are on this list, bring them in, put them in the barrel, and they can be used for those that are in need. We do a great job reaching our community. I could stand up here for the next half hour and say where it is that we've reached, and I'll bet you I still won't know it all, and you guys will take another half hour to say it. So we do a great job, and I want us to change gears just a little. I want us to also do a great job of showing abundant love within the church. So in order to do that, I want you to start thinking about what you hold on to. My guess is that many of you have at least one thing that you are holding on to that is special to you, that you cannot seem to part with, no matter how silly it is to keep. There are many things that I hold on to. This is one of them. Does anyone know what this is? In the 1990s, Rainbow Warriors, Jeff Gordon, DuPont. This was my now 32-year-old daughter's jacket when she was 5. And it still has the ice cream spill when we were at the races. It still has Jeff Gordon's number 24 little teddy bear. I love this jacket. I will not part with this jacket. It may seem silly to some, but it brings family memories to me from years past. It is special to me. I also have a piece of marble, which was a bit heavier than that jacket, that is about a half inch thick and about a one foot long square. And that marble used to go in a coffee table. And there is a picture that my mother has of me under the coffee table when I was about 7-8 months old, crawling. And I was crying profusely. I was in great pain. read the sarcasm. When my mother took the picture, I had hit my head on that marble piece in the coffee table. It means something to me. I carry it around because it's part of my family love. You guys also have things that you have that may not mean anything to anyone else, but you carry them around out of love. For some of us, though, we hold on to our money like that, as if once it's gone, we will never get it back. We will never have more. For some of us, we trust in money for our security more than we trust in God to keep us safe. What if I had a box up here, like a shoebox or a treasure trove box? And I said, okay, it is time. Whatever you have in your wallet or your purse, I want you to come up, whatever cash you have, and put it in this box. Some of you may say, man, I just went to the bank. Some of you may say, I wish I had more to give. Whatever your answer, it would be very dramatic. Rest easy. I don't have a box. But I want you to think about your answer. What would your answer have been and why? And would your answer change if I said, listen, and here's the thing, this box, after we put money in it from our wallets and purses, what I'm gonna do is at the end of service, I'm gonna be at the back door, and anyone who needs cash, anyone who has a need that needs to be filled, no questions asked, you go back there, I'll be right there, you take as much money as you need out of this box. Would your answer change about what you would put or how you feel about putting something in the box? Scripture today talks about the early church and how everyone gave what they had. They trusted that God would provide for their needs. They believed that what was given would be used for their needs and the needs of others in the church. Do you know the needs of those in your church? Do you know the struggles of the person sitting right next to you? Or five seats down, or those across the room? Being a church means that we know and assist in the needs of our church family. It's the next level of that vulnerability that we have for each other, showing an abundant love for each other. I'm going to read the scripture again from Acts 4, verses 32 through 35. All the believers were agreed in their heart and mind to give everything. They didn't claim that anything they had was their own. Instead, they shared everything they owned. And with great power, I want you to hear this, because they trusted God to care for them. With great power, the apostles continued their teaching. With great power, it didn't diminish because they gave everything. With great power, they continued to teach. Scripture says they were telling people that the Lord Jesus had risen from the dead and God's grace was working powerfully in all of them. God's grace to be humble, God's grace to be cared for, God's grace to care for others. Scripture says, so there were no needy persons among them. From time to time, those who had land and houses sold them. They brought the money from the sales and they put it down at the apostles' feet. It was then given to anyone who needed it. That imaginary box is as close as I can come. But think about how you would feel about that. They were humbled. They were cared for. They cared for others. They were vulnerable with each other. But it didn't last very long. The Acts church, Acts 2 and Acts 4 and a couple of chapters later, it doesn't last very long. Do you remember the Disney movie Finding Nemo? Does anyone remember that? Yes, Finding Nemo. So in one scene, and I almost had the sound people play it for us, but I felt like it was just going to be too stinking annoying, so I thought I would explain it instead. At one scene, there is a seagull, and he has this little bitty crab, and he's holding the crab up, and he's about to eat it. And there's a whole bunch of seagulls that are on a rock. And does anyone know, as he's about to eat it, what those seagulls do? What do they say? Mine, 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 mine. You're welcome for not playing that. Mine, mine, mine. Our scripture for today is awesome. But we like to think that everything is ours, like those seagulls in Finding Nemo. Scripture tells a story of Ananias and Sapphira, a married couple who had hid some resources from the church, and they lied about it. They said they had sold everything and they brought everything that they had to the feet of the apostles like everyone else did, but they did not. They withheld some. And so first the husband comes in and he says, here it is, here's everything. Well, he is struck down by God. He is dead. And so two people drag him off. There are dirt marks dragging out because God struck him dead. His wife comes in, not knowing that the husband is dead. The wife comes in, and she's asked the same question. Is everything here? Well, yes, everything is here. Do you see those scrape marks going out the door? That's your husband. He was struck dead for lying to God. And she also was struck dead for lying to God. It isn't that they withheld, it's that they lied. And it's not that they lied to the church. They lied to God about what they had. We are stewards over everything that God gives us. It is all His. Let us not lie about what we should give back. Let's release our grip a little. Now, Ananias and Sapphira, they had a pretty hard grip on their possessions, and they claimed to have a loose grip. If you're going to have a tight grip on your money, name it and claim it. Don't name it and claim it to me or to someone in the church. It's not our responsibility. No one in this church, myself included, is going to keep track of how much you are giving, because you don't have to name it and claim it to me. You have to name and claim it to God. Whatever you have and you do not want to give, even if you know you should, don't make excuses. Just name it and claim it. Now, if you want to have a loose grip, but you find it hard to do, join the crowd, because the majority of us, that's the case. And then if you want to have that loose grip, go to God in prayer. If you are one of those rare people who have an extravagant gift of generosity, I mean this seriously from the bottom of my heart, thank you. Because that is wonderful that you have that extravagant gift of generosity and it comes easy to you. And then if that is your gift, please pray for the rest of us, because we do need to do better. All of us need to do better in this area. And then along with going to God in prayer, include in your financial budget monetary giving to the church. Dave Ramsey has a great class. It's called Financial Peace University, and it teaches how to budget so that you can give as God intends. I have taught that class many times, and if there's enough parish interest, then I will teach it again, so let me know if you're interested in it. So when you give to the church, where does the money go? Your tithes and offerings are used to maintain the building, to pay the bills, to keep the lights on, to keep the fans going, to keep you comfortable whether it is summer or winter as far as AC or heat. It goes to paying the pastor. It goes to paying the church tithe to the conference, which is called apportionments. And then they then use it to pay their bills, various salaries, and important ministries of the world. And in theory, we should have enough as a local church to give extravagantly to those that are in need. But often churches throughout the nation don't have enough, because many attendees have seagull mentalities. So we are going to do a parish experiment. Remember I said I'm not going to ask you to put into the imaginary treasure box for at the end of the service. However, I do have an experiment I want us to all try. Through the end of the year, whenever you normally go to Starbucks, or to Scooters, or to Hy-Vee Coffee, or to lunch, for the next 3 months to the end of the year, what I want you to do is not do that. Sometimes not do that. You choose how often the sometimes is. And then whatever money you would normally spend, you put it in an envelope. And on the envelope, you're going to write abundant love offering. And then you're going to give it to the church. Now, for those finance people that are in the room that have to keep track of that, my apologies in advance. And what I want you to do is I want you to have a designated line item that says abundant love offering. And then the other part of that is, which might even be harder because it's easier for most of us to give than it is to receive that gift. It's a vulnerability thing. So if you need help, you're going to come to me, and it will be completely confidential. It's completely confidential how much you give. It's completely confidential to what you receive. If you need help with no questions asked, I will give you whatever you need for as long as there is money in that account. That's abundant love for our brothers and sisters in this space. If you're watching online and you are a church family, because we know that you are, it also applies to you. We will continue to assist in the community needs. Of course we will. This doesn't stop that. We will continue to give our normal tithes and offerings. This is above and beyond. We are not stopping. We have a praise offering, and we continue to give to that. Now, if you say, Pastor Julie, I can do one or the other. I can do the praise offering, or I can do the giving to the abundant love offering. I can't do both. Okay, you know what your situation is. You choose. This isn't me bringing down the hammer. It's me saying, let's grow. Let's have a stretch growth. Let's grow a little in this area together. Let's be vulnerable together. And as I said, it might be difficult to be the one that is asking, but this is how we tear down the fences we've talked about in the last few weeks and be vulnerable to each other. Now, back to our scripture. The people knew the truth of Jesus because the apostles and the first century church were giving their money and possessions to one another and talking about it. They weren't talking about it in a gossipy way. They were not talking about it specifically. They were talking about how it was a blessing to be a blessing. It was not a service project. It was not a homeless shelter. It was not a missions program. It was helping one another. They were talking about sacrificing and meeting the needs, which were abundant expressions of love. That's what I want us to do this week and beyond. The expressions of love. Amen. As we prepare our hearts for communion and partake with those around the world who are also doing that this week, I want you to prepare with a communion song, Come Share the Lord, in the Faith We Sing book, number 2269. Let us prepare our hearts for our Lord. Amen. On the night that Christ was betrayed, he did indeed take the bread, and he first blessed it, giving thanks to the Father. Let us come together in prayer. God, we do give you thanks. We give you thanks for the bread and the cup. You are the creator, the provider, the sustainer of all. And God, we come to this table reminding ourselves of what Christ the Lord has done for us, saving us so that we can be with you for all eternity, so that we can have relationship with you. Lord, we pray for those around the world, our brothers and sisters who also have taken or will take from the table of the Lord. God, we share in the thanks and the love that we have for you. Amen. After giving thanks, Jesus took the bread and he broke it. And he said, This is my body broken for you. And every time you take of this bread, you do this in remembrance of me until I come again. After the meal, Christ took the cup and he said, This is my blood that is shed for you and for the many. Take this bread, drink of this cup, and do this in remembrance of me until I come again. Amen. This is the Lord's table. Anyone who calls Jesus Lord and Savior is welcome at this table. It's my understanding that the kids learned a little bit about communion and what it means today. And so, in an abundance of caring for the smallest of Christ followers, we will start with them first, and then the rest of us will come together. If you would prefer to be served where you are seated, please stay exactly where you are, and we will come to you. While you're online, you've heard me say it before, it's not about what you are having, it is about who you remember and whose you are. So whether it is a cookie and coffee, which we might in the sanctuary be a little jealous about, that's a sin. Sorry, a little pastoral humor. We recognize and the sacrifice that Christ has given for each one of us. Come to the table. So ushers, I'm going to have you come up, but at the same time, Lane and Claire, if you would like to, you can come up and I will serve you guys while the ushers are coming forward. And if you don't want to, it's okay. My sister, that is Christ's body broken for you and his blood shed for you. Amen. Ushers? My sister? Christ's body broken for you and his blood shed for you. Amen. My sister, Christ's body broken for you and his blood shed for you. Amen. Come to the Lord's table. Is there anyone that we missed? Let us continue with our worship of our Lord with our tithes and offerings. Would you stand as you're able for the doxology? Lord, we thank you for everything that you bless us with. We know that everything that we have is yours. It comes from you, and you allow us to be stewards over it. So, Lord, as we return a portion of what we have, use it, multiply it, bring people to you that need to know your love and the family of Christ. In your Son's name, amen. Please be seated. For our mission, ministry, and God sightings, we have several opportunities. One of the missions, ministries that we have is our praise offering, as I have mentioned to you. And so we're not going to give an update today on that. We will give them every now and again, but the praise offering is basically going above and beyond what you already give. And that was started by several generous souls, and so we will continue to let you know how that goes. And then, Barb, you had a mission opportunity that you wanted to talk about. Yes. So I'm going to repeat that so everyone online and maybe those of you that couldn't hear it. So United Women of Faith, the United Women of Faith has gotten together for our church, and they've decided that they are going to give $500 to the warming shelter, and they are going to challenge other churches to match that or to do what they can to contribute to the warming shelter. So hopefully Barb will give us more information on that as that challenge unfolds. So thank you, United Women of Faith. That is a wonderful opportunity. So thank you. We also have various ministries that we want to show you on our website, which is very close to being online. So in the next few weeks, what you'll do is you'll see it in our bulletin, but then you can test it out and find all of the places where we need to do better. We look forward to the challenge. And the ministry opportunities that you will see on our website: Outreach Mondays, Food Bank, Bible Study, Helping Hands, Helping Others, Team Kids, Vacation Bible School, United Methodist Women, United Methodist Men, Zoom Book Club, Card Fellowship, Service at Regency Care Center, and there are many more, I am sure. So if you, once our website is up and running, if you don't see the one that you're involved in, I want you to contact Kathy at the office, because we want to make sure that we include everything. So great job being the church. Nice job. And then we also want to just praise the new for the last several years, opportunity to be in mission with our kids at Sunday school. And kids, we could not do that without you. So we appreciate you guys being here. And hopefully Wyatt will be here next week. I think he's out having some fun other places this Sunday. All right, so any other mission and ministry that I've missed? Birthdays, anniversaries? Yes, ma'am, of course, don't be silly. Donna, we are so glad that both of you guys are here, and we are going to sing with you in just a minute. Let's make sure there's no other birthdays or anniversaries to include. Go ahead, say it loudly. Yes? Yes? October 23rd. All right, nice. Here's the thing. I do not promote just pointing at someone. If you have the courage to point, you have the courage to speak. That's the way I say it. Listen, I'm not going to get in trouble on your behalf. You can get in trouble. All right, nice. Any others? Let's hit it with happy birthday. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday, God bless you. Happy birthday to you. Very good. And I think I am also going to say that there was a wedding over the weekend, and we praise God for a wedding. So tell us a little bit. Beautiful. And your daughter's name and her new husband is? Iverson. Jenna and John Iverson. So congratulations to them, and you pass that on when they get back from their honeymoon. Very good. Your youngest daughter accepted to law school. God bless her, and it's a road, man. Good for her. All right. And God sightings. I think those were two God sightings. I had a God sighting this morning. I pulled up, and there was not a place for me to park except parallel parking, which I know I'm going to pat myself on the back. I'm good at parallel parking. I excel at parallel parking. But as I started to do it, I went, listen, I've got 2 minutes. I'm riding, going to the back. So I did like cop out on the whole parallel parking thing. But I challenge you to have enough people here where that happens to me all the time. That was awesome to see, the fact that there was no parking out front. That was great. That is my God sighting. Okay, anyone else? God sightings. Okay, keep looking for them. Look for them in the beautifully painted sunrises and sunsets. Look for them in the beautiful colors of the leaves. Look for them in our little bunny out here and our little squirrel out here. That'll become important sometime in the next few weeks. Look for the way that God is blessing you just in the people that he brings to your lives. So this week, we're doing something a little bit different. This week, we don't have a closing hymn. This week, what we have is a closing prayer for World Communion Sunday. Now, that prayer comes in part, mostly, from the United Methodist resources that I have. I have changed it a little, but I'm not going to ask you to stand. We will pray together. And whoever is our candle person, oh, I see her coming. So you are welcome to come up at any time. Just wait until I say amen for the candle. Otherwise, you might be standing there for a little while. Okay? All right, let us join together in prayer. Lord of justice and fairness, each of our understandings of love and justice is partial, but Lord, you are full. In our history, we make efforts to love. Sometimes we do that really well, and sometimes we don't. And sometimes when we don't do love well for others, it's harmful. God, we may speak the same language, but sometimes we understand it differently, and sometimes the hurt from this misunderstanding gives birth to another harm or even violence. God, we accept that this is our reality and this is our limit. However, perfect Lord, you make us full with your flesh and blood. You save our lives with the grace that saved our souls. We cannot save ourselves, but you give life to the world through us. And we want to become like you. You who gave us life through flesh and blood. God, you empathize with humans by incarnating yourself to us. Now let us go and empathize with our surroundings as you did for us. And let us be the good Samaritans. Ruler of all, Lord of all creation, we give thanks that you came to us today through your flesh and blood at the communion table. Your love for us exceeds how we think of each other. Your love is great to cover our different looks, and your love is living peace that embraces each of us. You make us remember each of the unique images that you gave us from the beginning. Let us all accept and remember that you loved each of us differently and in different ways. And let us love as you love. In the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord and our Restorer, we pray. Amen. Have a blessed week, everyone.